So this is just three examples. There is actually 42 species that are recognized at the moment. There are 16 genera. And I just put a few pictures up here so that you actually can get an idea about the diversity. As you will see in a little bit later, the variation is actually pretty recent. It's about 25 million years that developed into extraordinary phenotypes. Not just like the feather colors, but they have weird feather types that you don't see in many other birds. They do, some of them have very elaborate pecking dances, some do nothing at all. So there's a whole variety of phenotypes that you can find. So take the risk. Okay, so basically what you can see here is that this is a really nice feather types. They have some really weird feathers, like the red bird of paradise up here. You can see all these different colors and weird shapes. And in the right top, they do have some really interesting colorations. So they use both structural and pigmentary coloration. And actually, the main lenses, they use the reflection of the light, so the angle of the light, so they can actually get really amazing colors during their behavior. Some of them, like I said, do all these very complicated orchid lenses, some don't. It's actually good. Nowadays, actually, where can you find them? You have them almost exclusively up here in the north, in Papua New Guinea, or in New Guinea in general. You have some on the Moluccas, which is the island group west, northwest of New Guinea. And you do have a few that live on the eastern, most eastern part of Australia, or in kind of the main forest type areas. Okay, so my former boss, once I finished my PhD, I decided to go to Sweden, and my former boss was very much into birds of paradise, and he published one of the, or at the moment, the kind of like the most comprehensive phylogenetic study. This is all 42 birds, bird of paradise species, and what he found is that there are five different traits, and the basal one that is called A here, is basically all monochromatic, non-locking, pecking birds. It's kind of like, for example, you will see the paradise crow here in the base. That's basically looks like a crow with a little bit of blue in it. But then all the other species, E and E, have very elaborate colors, feather types, and pecking behavior. So we decided to actually sequence, for the pilot project, to sequence one genome per plate. And so our data set here is, so we have the Huonostrophia here down here. We have the red paradise bird, we have rifle bird, we have the king of Saxony bird, and then this year was the paradise crow. And then there's an owl group that was 5 years ago, and when they made bird genomes out yet. We used the flycatcher, zebrafinch, and then for genome, because also the one hand is birds of paradise are belonging to the COVID family, and on the other hand, those are kind of like the better bird genomes at the time. And here you see kind of like the radiation is like this is the group of all the birds of paradise here. This is what we refer to the core birds of paradise. So this is the ones that are more privy to all the pecking dances and everything. And the radiation here started somewhere between 20 and 35 million years. So quite a so the first thing we did is we did, the paradise crow, rifle bird, and the Huonostrophia, we did the mobile, and the other two actually on the same samples. We looked at the synteny, so we compared it to the flycatcher genome, that is pretty much the full chromosome level genome. We found that they're actually very conserved, and that's something that has been known in birds. It's pretty much you can compare a chicken with a flycatcher, and you will find that it's very conserved. Now we're even closer. We do see a few lines here, so if you haven't looked at this kind of plot, this here are the chromosomes of the flycatcher. This here are kingdom scaffolds from the birds of paradise. and then they have the same color, for example, here on chromosome 1. All these scaffolds here actually align back to the chromosome 1 in the flycatcher, all these purple ones here, the chromosome 2, and so on. You do see sometimes, like here, where it's going to the blue, but then from this violet here, we're going to the blue one, and this is where actually where one part of, in this scaffold here, part of the scaffold actually maps to this chromosome, and the other part maps to this chromosome. We do know that there's quite a bit of fission fusion going on in chromosomes in birds, but it could also most likely might be some issue with the assembly. And so now we actually have one genome that I will talk about very briefly later that we need to respect bio, and IC, so it's good on chromosome level now. But overall, pretty much we saw that they're very, very conserved. We also looked at repeat content, and that's something that we've heard in another session today, something that is often overlooked. But they do have important functions in evolution. They, for example, facilitate gene duplication, they shape the structure of the chromosome, and they can also suppress recombination, as we'll show in another slide. Basically, what we see here is in yellow we have the lines, so it's the line elements. Blue ones here are LTRs, green unknown, and DNA and China just not very present, so you can't see that in the plot. But basically, we see two things in this analysis. On the one hand is we have this big expansion in line elements. This is mostly CR1E. And that's a feature that is actually very common in songbirds. So it has been shown in other songbirds, and they're all kind of like timing-wise the same. For our project, it was very interesting that we see this kind of like, it's not super clear, but we see these small bursts of new LTRs, retroviral LTRs. And the interesting thing here is that it's completely new families of LTRs that you don't find in any other songbirds. So it's something very specific to birds of paradise. The other thing why it's actually interesting is a colleague of mine, Ji Su, they have a spin-off, a follow-up project where they're looking actually at the sex chromosome evolution in birds of paradise. And what they looked at, so this here is the Z chromosome in birds. And they looked at what they call evolution strata. So these are areas of the sex chromosome where recombination is suppressed. And so you get these kind of like blocks. You see here the color coded, blue is the oldest one, and then yellow and then orange and red is the newest one. And the interesting thing why I'm showing this here is because one thing they found in birds of paradise and also some other songbirds is this risk. And the newest one, so this is the S0, actually they think, so most of these strata changes here are just inversions, the big inversions, and so they don't recombine anymore. But in the S3 here, it looks like it's actually caused by repeats, and you see this big, so this is the plot here, so this is this evolutionary strata, this is an area here that actually recombines, and you see that exactly at the junction, you see this strong increase in this here on line element. And so the current hypothesis is that this accumulation of repeats actually suppresses the recombination in that area. And so it's kind of like interesting. We don't really know yet how repeats play a role, especially on birds of paradise, but it seems that they play a role quite a bit in some birds, and so maybe also even in birds of paradise. The next thing that we looked at is pretty much the standard thing. We looked at gain and loss, so expansion and contraction of gene families. We found a few interesting things. So first, let's go to this slide. So we did positive selection tests, and we did what's called a kind of like a branch type test. So we actually specifically looked at selection on this branch here, so leading to the birds of paradise. And what we found is we found 213 genes that show signatures of positive selection out of 8,134 that we looked at, so that's actually not a lot. But the branch type test always has a bit of an issue with power, because we only have now case 4 species and only one individual per species. We're kind of like torn. We did in the end do a multiple testing correction. The problem is that most of these tools actually assume a uniform distribution, and so your p-values are kind of like uniformly distributed, but what we see is we have almost 8,000 that are not significant at all, and then we have 213 that are somewhat significant or really significant. And so with most of these multiple testing corrections, we actually correct out all the true positives. That's a bit of an issue. We did find a few really interesting genes in the set, both in the non-corrected and in the corrected ones. And some of them actually make really good sense. So we found genes important for coloration in our selection. NTS20, for example, that is known to cause color formation in the lumbar region in mammals. We do have some genes that are known to be important for feather development in birds, and given the whole array of different feather types, it's also a pretty interesting candidate to look at further. We do see a lot of genes that are actually involved in bone development, especially in the brain and facial area, and we do see a whole different skull morphology and beak shapes in the birds, so that's also interesting. One thing we didn't expect, but which somehow makes sense, although it's not as easy to explain, is actually we see a lot of genes that are under selection for eye development. And so birds are actually very good. We see a whole array of colors, much better than mammals. And in birds of paradise, what we think might be the cause why they're actually under such strong selection is because they have lots of different colors. They use them in the mating lenses, but also they use basically like reflection of the light in their lenses, and so they need to be able to really see all the fine nuances and lenses to actually know which partner is the most promising one. But as actually we've looked at the literature, and there's a lot of discussion if you can actually find a link between selection on the visual system and coloration in birds and stuff. It's not that simple, unfortunately. But it will be kind of like easy to explain things, so we want to follow up on that to some extent. And we found some immune response and immune response genes in the positive selection. One is actually pretty interesting because it is a gene that is important for suppression of retroviral LTR insertion. That's actually, if you think back to the repeat plots, that's one of the big things we saw in the birds of paradise. The next thing we looked at is actually gene family extension contractions. And these are actually the colors here. So in green, I guess, we have the regions. We have in purple here the contractions, the family. And in orange, we have the one that's actually significantly enriched or physically decreased. We see in this case, we actually look mostly at this branch and this branch. Again, we have more power, but also that's actually what the paper is about, is the evolution of birds of paradise. And so we found 18 significantly expanded gene families in the birds of paradise, so the branch to the birds of paradise, and 21 to the branch of the core birds of paradise. So those are all the like nice colors and gradient dances and everything. Lots of the low terms that we found were just cellular function and stuff. We found two that are actually really interesting. One is gene family that is important for startup response in motor motoric behavior. If you've never heard about startup response, it's basically the ability to react quickly to a stimuli or stimulus. For the birds of paradise, we think they could have a few things. The interesting thing is we do find it mostly the highest extension in the Paradisea group, and those are actually the birds of paradise that have the most exposed legs. Are in the treetop, they jump around, they do all their dances, they actually have to be on the lookout for predators, like reptiles and stuff, and if one comes, they have to react quickly. Actually, it's biologically shown that they always do. of surprising, and it's a system or kind of like sensory system that is not often thought about when you look at birds. It's the odor receptor, so the olfactory system, so it's a smell. And we looked at our data, we compared it to the literature, and we see that the zebrafinch actually has the highest enrichment, which is also published before. Several studies have found the same, so that tells us that our analysis looks pretty promising. We do see that it's actually strongly expanded, similar to the starting response for the core birds of paradise. So those are the ones that do all the legs, some of them do the legs. But it's actually suppressed or like down decreased in the paradise crawl.